Welcome, everybody. My name is Gary. I'm with the Caregiver Foundation, and I'm honored to be able to share some thoughts with you today. But before I do that, if you're on the island of Oahu and don't have anything better to do on Saturday, the mayor's annual Christmas craft fair is happening. It's always a fun event with lots of interesting things. You can get a head start on Christmas shopping. I thought there'll also be over 40, I guess you call them booths, with people who work with seniors or folks with disabilities in a lot of different ways. So you might want to stop in and chat with the different ones that are there. Caregiver Foundation will have somebody down there, so stop in and say hi. So I'll give that a plug. So who am I? I am a caregiver. I've seemed to have been a caregiver a very long time since I was a kid. It's interesting when I look at my life as a caregiver, that was never what I thought I was doing. And I think most people who are in a caregiving situation today don't really see themselves in that light. We're taking care of a loved one. We're helping somebody, we're doing shopping for somebody, we're doing all these different things, but we don't really say, oh, by the way, I'm a caregiver. But maybe we should a little more often, because caregiving is a very special way of helping someone else. And caregiving doesn't necessarily mean you're doing everything. It can be one set of things. Maybe you're helping somebody manage their household, or maybe you're helping somebody manage their finances, or taking them to the doctor, or taking them shopping, or doing the shopping for them. All those components make you caregivers. So next time you're out doing something for somebody, pat yourself on the back and say, good, you're a good caregiver. There. So, but as you know, caregiving can also bring with it a lot of stress, a lot of anxiety, and a lot of what do I do now comments in your mind. The one thing that I hear from most people who are deep into caregiving is, how on earth are we going to pay for this? Do I quit a job and stay home full time and take care of mom or dad? Do I hire caregivers in, but at anywhere from $25 to $65 an hour? How am I going to finance that? All these different factors have to be looked at, and very realistically. So I thought today I would share some ideas on paying for long-term care. There are three main sources. The first one is if you have enough money, you can private pay for any kind of care assistance that you need, whether it's caregivers coming in, nurses coming in, housekeepers coming in, whatever it is. If you have the adequate finances, you can make those choices and pay for it privately. Folks who have purchased long-term care insurance may be able to pay for part of the care through their long-term care insurance policy. There's a lot of twists and turns to using a long-term care insurance policy. So we'll go over that a little bit later, but you have to pay very close attention to the actual contract to make sure that you get things covered. And then there's the government. And the government will pay for long-term care services in the home if you don't have anything. And I mean, really don't have anything. $2,000 or less in spendable assets. You can stay in your home. They don't make you liquidate your home, but they will put a lien on it so that when you pass or when your loved one passes, they can ask for that home to be liquidated and pay them back, unless an adult child has been providing care for a fairly long period of time in that home. Then the house can actually be transferred to that child. You can put your house in an irrevocable trust. That makes it not countable, but you have to wait 5 years for it not to be countable. So most people don't plan 5 years in advance to make sure that they can get Medicaid. There are attorneys who do a good business in helping you plan that ahead, but for most people, that's not the best option. But it's a good option for the people that need that option. So, what are some alternatives? Well, there are reverse mortgages, home equity loans, long-term care insurance, loans secured by life insurance, family caregiver contracts, selling your house or your condo, mostly it applies to condos, selling the condo and then renting it back. That gives you cash to hire caregivers, and often the rent is lower than your monthly maintenance fee. But that means you're not going to be able to leave that condo to any loved one or anyone else. So those things to bear in mind. So reverse mortgages, what are they? They are a way of accessing the equity in your property. A company will loan you approximately 60% of the value of that property. You don't have to make payments on it. The initial startup costs usually average about 9% of the loan, so you immediately have money due on the loan, but you don't have to pay it. It keeps increasing just like a regular loan, but when you pass away, if you're going to leave it to someone, they need to sell it or they need to pay off the reverse mortgage. If you're not going to leave it to somebody, family can just walk away, and the company that loaned the money will take the title on the property. Some of the companies do it very quickly. They file for it. I've had companies wait 2 years and had places just sitting there empty for 2 years before they got around to actually changing the deed over and then asking us to sell the place for them. Home equity loans also access the equity in your home, but those loans do have monthly payments. So you have to really do the math very carefully on home equity loans to see if it is something that can be sustained with your income. But it is a valid way of accessing a pretty good size amount of cash for most people that can be used to pay caregivers or other care costs. We mentioned long-term care insurance. Long-term care insurance is a wonderful way to pay for long-term care. If you have it, and if you qualified, and if you have at least two of the activities of daily life compromised by your need for care, that means not able to take a bath by yourself, not able to dress yourself, not able to feed yourself, not able to manage your toileting yourself, not able to move from a chair to the bed, what they call transferring. These different areas has to be significantly compromised in order for your long-term care insurance to be effective. So you won't get anything if all you are is saying, I just want to stay home. I don't want to go anywhere else. I'll get my long-term care insurance to pay for somebody to come in and clean my house. Unless it's a very old policy, you're not going to find that that's covered anymore. Now, if you are in a condo or an apartment, it might make sense to sell the place and try and get either another place in the same area or have the new owner rent the place back to you. So let's say you have a condominium that's worth $500,000. You could sell that condominium, realize probably around $450,000. That gives you a chunk of cash. If you rented it back, you could probably rent it for around $2,000, and that could very well be less than the maintenance fee and the insurance on your current in your current situation. So again, you have to look at the figures and study it out. And then with all of these, if it's involving real estate, you've got to make real clear choices. If you use the equity in real estate, that will affect what you're able to leave any of your heirs. If that's okay, then this is a way that some people have found made a lot of sense for them. The cost of care here in Hawaii is not cheap. The cost of care on the mainland is lower, but it has been going up very quickly also. But here in Hawaii, if you have someone coming into your house and they are qualified at, say, a certified nurse's assistant level, CNA level, you can expect to spend anywhere from 25, 28 to about $46 an hour. If you need a nurse coming in, that goes up to about $65 to $80 an hour. So if you had someone actually living essentially with you, 24 hours, 7 days a week, you could expect to spend between $15,000 and $25,000 a month, and that would be a pretty good price. So even if you have a lot of money, you start thinking, how long is it going to last? If you have nice retirement fund and you've got $500,000 in there, you've got about 2.5 years. So if you're not planning to check out in 2.5 years, you got to do some real careful thinking. But long-term care at home depends on what kind of care you need, the level of care, who's going to provide it, how many hours will you need, and where is the care? Both of my parents are on hospice and they live in Pupuakea. Getting a caregiver from any company to go through the turtle traffic to provide a few hours of care has proven impossible. We can't get anybody to do that. We're very lucky in that we have found some CNA level care on the North Shore that we've been able to contract in to give us a little bit of help. But you've got to realize these caregivers today are in high demand. None of them want to work 2 or 3 hours. They want 8 hour shifts, just like a real job. 8 hours, that's a lot of money coming out. And most people don't actually need a full 8 hours. I've had many people ask me, oh, can I get a caregiver for 2 hours in the morning and then an hour around lunch and then another 2 hours around dinner time? And my answer is, I doubt it. I don't think I can find anyone to do that. So you have to think of that. And figuring out the cost of care and what you can afford means you've got to be very clear on what your finances are. Now, let me back up a minute. It's not your finances unless you're receiving the care. This would be the finances related to the person for whom care is being provided. If it's your parents, that would be their resources, not your resources. And I'll go into that a little bit more. But you have to, and you really have to know what they have so that you can do the figuring out. Like I said before, if you've got plenty of money, you've got plenty of choices. But when money starts getting tight, those choices become fewer and fewer and harder to make a good choice. Medicaid is for those who don't have resources. Usually here on Oahu, they're not going to let you age in place. They're going to say you need to go to a community foster home in the community. So, community foster homes can have three people, two of them on Medicaid and one private pay, or they can have one private pay and one Medicaid qualified person. Most of them are well run and run by very kind and compassionate families. Some of them are not good. So if you find yourself in a Medicaid situation, my recommendation is to go through a very good Medicaid qualified case manager. We use several, so if you want some referrals on that, let me know. They get paid by the state. It's not an extra amount that you have to pay. Some Medicaid homes will try to get you to agree to pay more than Medicaid pays. Don't do it. It's illegal. They could lose their license, and that's not how it's supposed to work. So you've got to know the financial picture very, very clearly. What do they have in investments? What kind of savings do they have? What kind of income? Can they do a reverse mortgage? Could they do loans? How much can a family contribute? What about inheritance contracts? What's that? And then Medicaid. So these four steps are really important. And they're not a one-time deal. It's going to change over time. As someone's level of care changes, their need for outside care coming in may go up as well. And that means the cost would go up also. So do a really thorough review of the resources. Work with someone to develop a plan of care. This is where a case manager is really valuable. They can help you actually design a plan of care that makes sense. But you've got to be very, very realistic and honest with both yourself and with the person that's receiving care. Now, if that person is suffering from a cognitive impairment, that conversation is not going to work. It's all going to fall back on you and whoever else is involved in the care. But it's not okay for you to say, we'll work it out. That's not a good way to respond to figuring out how you're going to manage long-term care finances. That will lead you into complete stress and total burnout at some point. Having a plan, making sure it's smart, making sure it is realistic and can work will lessen the stress on everybody and result in better care for the person that you love. And I have no idea what that's doing in there. So ignore that one and that one. So planning is so important that you're able to keep your sanity because you have a plan. So let's go over really briefly this thing called an inheritance contract. Now, I'm not giving any legal advice. If you find this interesting, I can refer you to a couple of attorneys that can help draft it because it should be something drafted by an attorney. What it is, it's someone usually in the family who's saying, I will provide care. That care on the market is worth X. Every year, I will add up what that is. That amount will be applied against any of my siblings' inheritance in repayment for my taking care of someone. So let's say somebody's lucky, dad bought a home for $10,000 and it's worth $1 million today. But otherwise, he doesn't have any money. You might decide, well, I'll take early retirement. I'll go home and take care of dad. That care is worth about $180,000 a year. So if you have three or four siblings and everyone's expecting to inherit one fourth of that $1 million, those siblings have to agree with you that the care you provide is worth that 180,000. That is going to be considered unearned income. So you have to work with the CPA to make sure the tax side of it is carefully thought of also. Those siblings, every year you would want them to do this, would sign a document that your attorney would prepare saying that they agree that the amount earned in that year, even though it wasn't paid, it will come out of the eventual inheritance. And you will be paid for the time that you spent caregiving before any inheritance is distributed at all. I will tell you that this idea is great when there are no siblings. Works real well. When there are siblings, it does not usually work well. No matter what people say today, when it comes right down to it, all of a sudden they go, I never agreed to that. That's where you have to have an attorney involved, and it gets legally reviewed every single year. It's real critical. Otherwise, you're going to find yourself at the end of caregiving, and you'll have been the caregiver, but everybody else is getting the same amount. That usually leaves a lot of hard feelings. So, again, the four things that you can do: have a lot of money, pay for the care. I have a few clients. We have some clients right now that regularly we're spending around $20,000 to $30,000 a month for their care. They're in a position where they actually have the money to do that. So that's what we're doing. We have other clients whose income is quite high, And so they're able to pay for a private care home at about $6,000 a month, which is far cheaper than aging at home with the same level of care. Their income is supplemented as needed by their savings and investments. We have other people who have a limited amount in the bank, and their income is not that high, so their assets will be spent down much more quickly than those whose income is high, of course. So if they're paying $5,000 or $6,000 a month for care and they're only bringing in $3,000, then $2,000 a month is going to be coming out of their assets or their investments. And for those who don't have good income and they don't have assets that are available to be spent, those are the perfect people to have Medicaid coverage. Applying for Medicaid is not so easy. It can be very, very frustrating, lots of paperwork, and you get the feeling when you're applying for Medicaid that they're trying very hard not to give you any benefit, that they're trying to disqualify you. Honestly, that's not too far off the truth. Medicaid has a limited pool of funds, and those go for seniors, for kids, for all the different programs that the Medicaid umbrella covers. It's a limited pot of funds, so they're working really hard to try and make it stretch for everything. So if they can find that you're not really qualified, they're not going to bend over backwards to help you become qualified. Some people want to become qualified for Medicaid regardless. You can do that. Work with an estate planning attorney or someone who specializes in Medicaid planning. A real good person over here is named Scott Gardner, Scott Gardner and Associates. That's all they do is work on Medicaid. Good people to call. If that's something that you think is going to be needed in your future, I recommend that. We don't do Medicaid planning at the Caregiver Foundation. We do the applications and we do the administering of the Medicaid benefits, but we don't do the actual estate type of planning because we are not attorneys, and you should use an attorney. Please do not use your friend over the back fence. That will usually get you in trouble. Find a very well qualified attorney, preferably one who's part of the National Association of Elder Law Attorneys. They are usually well versed and they have a good set of standards that they're supposed to follow to remain very ethical and work very appropriately with people. So those are the four areas that work for financing. It is not easy. When you're looking at how am I going to pay for long-term care, it's not your money that needs to be paying for that. Don't get yourself into a trap where you are spending all of the money that you have for your retirement on someone's care. If your loved one does not have the resources to pay for their own care, that is when you should look at Medicaid. In my opinion, it's a mistake to spend what you have because your kids are going to be faced with now what? Mom and dad don't have any resources. They spent it all on grandpa. Their world is going to be much harder than our world today because there's fewer of them paying into any system, which means Medicaid's going to lose even more funding. So be careful, take care of yourself. If you can, talk to an insurance agent about long-term care insurance. Find out if it works for you. The insurance industry has done some very interesting change. They've made several changes in how that insurance is sold. You can now buy a policy that covers you for life insurance or long-term care insurance. And if you don't use any of it, you can use it in retirement or you can cash it out. So there are lots of options today that didn't exist even 5 years ago. Look into it with your insurance agent. So I'm going to let you ask me questions now. So I think
Okay.
that's the best way to
Oh,
go.
thank you. Thank you, Gary. This is Leanne, and while the caregivers are putting questions into the chat, we do have one, and then I can always ask you some from my list.
Okay.
So the first question is, do we need an attorney to do a care plan?
No. What you need is a care manager or a care coordinator. So you could look up case management agencies. We work with several. We work with Ohana Case Management. They're real good. But there are many. You just look up case management and you'll be able to find someone out there and interview them. Figure out if you're comfortable with them. If you're not, go to the next company and find one that will help you. Often they will help you look at the Medicaid side of things or the private pay side of things. We have many clients that have case managers that are paid privately to oversee the care that they receive in a private care home. And that's a good thing. If you have the funds to be able to do that, that's an excellent thing to do. But especially with any Medicaid situation, you want to have a case manager. Don't do it yourself. That's what they're there for.
Okay, I have another question about attorneys. So, if the caregiver and loved one lives on a neighbor island, can they work with an attorney on Oahu, say for Medicaid or the inheritance contract or some of the other financing plans that you talked about?
Yes. Most of the firms here are able to work with anybody, either virtually. We have several attorneys who regularly fly to the neighbor islands and work with clients over there. Many of our clients, especially Maui and the Big Island, we have attorneys that we are very comfortable with on Kauai. So we don't bother flying folks from Oahu over there for that. But yeah, you can work with clients. As long as they're licensed in the state of Hawaii, they should be able to help you.
Okay, that's good to know. Going back to the reverse mortgage, is that for the primary residence only, and it's not on, say, any rental income, rental property or
Yes, it's on the primary residence. And it's intended to be used for someone who is living in that home.
okay.
So it's not intended for you to get a reverse mortgage and then move into a private care home. That's not the intent because annually you have to say, yes, I'm still living in this home. And you don't want to be lying to the reverse mortgage company or they'll call the contract on you and you'll need to either pay them or liquidate the house to pay them. Or they could take title. So, just be cautious. It's a very good way to get money in the right circumstance.
Okay. A follow-up question about case managers. Is there a certification for case managers?
They are licensed by the Department of Health. And so they have they have rules and things that they're supposed to follow. And especially in reporting the care someone is receiving, they're the eyes and ears of the Department of Health. So they're supposed to make sure that that person is receiving the right quality of care. They're reviewing the logs that the caregiver maintains on the client, making sure the medication is being prescribed and administered properly, and that the level of care is being provided at the appropriate levels. So they're licensed.
Okay, so when interviewing case managers, then the caregiver would ask to see the license, and that's from the state of Hawaii. Okay.
And you can
Okay.
also look them up online at the Department of Health website.
Oh, okay. We
Both the
should.
care homes,
We should.
licensed care homes, and licensed case managers, you can look up online.
Okay, we should get that
Yeah, I'll
link
get that link for you.
for a future e-newsletter. So the care home. So when you say care home, does that mean adult residential? I mean,
Adult, either
all
one,
at
adult
versus
residential care home or
assisted.
community foster home.
Okay.
They're actually licensed in two different branches, but it gets a little confusing. So The big umbrella is they're licensed by the state, either to run a care home or to run a case management agency.
Okay, and in the chat, we just got a referral to a law firm on Maui. So this leads to the question, can residents on Oahu work with the Maui?
As long as the Maui attorney wants to work with you, sure.
Yeah,
Open
I guess.
Is a firm that's been working over on Maui for a long time.
Yeah, I guess in the age of Zoom, you know, we can work with professionals on different islands. That's good to know.
Yeah.
I want to encourage caregivers to put questions into the chat, because I don't know if, you know, your questions versus my questions. So please feel free. The inheritance contract, is that a lump sum that's paid to the caregiver at the time of the distribution of the estate?
Yes. But it's reported as, it's where you have to work with the attorney and the CPA, because you don't want to end up with a situation where suddenly you're having to report $400,000 of income.
I know.
You know, you're going to be in a pretty high tax bracket, and that can hurt. So you've got to make sure that you're doing the contract in a very carefully planned way with the attorney and with the help and advice of a CPA, so that it's all moving along very carefully.
Okay. I want to thank Gary for sharing his PowerPoint presentation, and I want to invite all of the caregivers to continue to stay on the call. We're going to turn off the video.